Whether you're starting out, halfway through, or a professional who scaled success to heights, the question always remains the same. What would they think of me? And in that moment, it feels like we're surrounded by constant judgment, competition, and competence. We are left to think that the other person's always right, and perhaps start to feel that the right thing to do is to just stay as an overarching spectator in a story that belongs to someone else. My own doubts about being immune to judgment has stopped me from publishing many pieces of work that were meant so dearly for the world to see, but only to remain in a coma under the bedsheets of my computer. Even if you consider yourself the most confident person in the world, I'm sure you've had this experience where you just want the other person to do the talking and you can't take no for an answer. And so in this video, I want to take you through three powerful ideas that have helped me cope up with the feeling of being judged and for taking no for an answer. Everything got better for me when I made peace with the fact that you have to be the fool sometimes and actually go through the experience of being judged. We live in a world where "I don't know" are arguably the three most judged words in the English literature. And yet when I look at some of the people I admire the most special thing about them wasn't the fact that they possessed skills that I wanted, like masterful storytelling and writing, but it's that they had this magical tendency of putting themselves out there despite the risk of being judged. This is something that people along the lines of Kevin Hart have spoken about. If you didn't realize by now, I am a huge Kevin Hart fan.
Running 60 miles per hour, I am not playing. His body was still freezing this way, but his head was like this.
There's no doubt that Kevin is one of the most talented storytellers in the history of comedy, but so are 1,000 others. What strikes me the most is his willingness to learn by putting himself out there in the position of being a fool. A great example of this is the story of how he met Jeff Bezos for the first time. He explains how he was in a room full of celebrities, a very high-profile room, where prides and egos were being protected at the highest priority, and coming off as an admirer would likely have an effect on your self-image.
And I'm with my wife and a friend, and Jeff Bezos walks in. My friend go, "There go Jeff Bezos." I said, "Oh shit, I'm gonna go say what's up." I said, "That's a motherfucker. I would love to pick his brain. That's an interesting individual." "No, don't do that." "What do you mean, don't do that?"
"Who said don't do
my
that?"
"My friend." Don't do that." "Why? What are you talking about? Why are you gonna do that, Kev? It's a room full of people. Don't look like the dude that's thirsty." "Thirsty for what? I want to see my face. I want to ask him some questions. I ain't gonna see this man no more. I don't know him. We're not on a phone number to phone number basis. I'm gonna say what's up to him." "All right, Kev, do you? I'm just saying, in this environment, just chill. It's relaxed. And that shit start to click to me. That's the problem. Everybody's too cool. Everybody's too fucking cool.
Right.
Everybody wants you to think that they know. You don't know. You don't know shit. We don't know shit."
A closer to home example is how Dhanush, despite being such a celebrated actor here in India, was willing to audition for a role he was recently casted in. Now let's face it, Dhanush is not the smartest looking actor and most certainly not the most articulate, especially for a Hollywood film. But just that willingness to get into the audition room, to unlearn, relearn, despite the risk of looking like a fool, is something to be appreciated. Now I've personally been in a couple of rooms where if I had just forgotten my pride for a second and walked up to the person I wanted to talk to, my life could have completely taken a different alternative. But in those situations now, I tell myself, what's the worst thing that could happen? You could end up looking like a fool, a misfit. But hey, maybe it's the misfits who have a chance in this world after all. The second principle that has worked for me is to understand that there's no such thing as a stupid question. Because at the core of it, many of life's greatest inventions came from one simple dumb question. The dumbest questions led Albert Einstein to some of his most profound breakthroughs. For instance, when he was 16 years old, Einstein pondered to himself, "What would happen if I chased after a beam of light?" Now, most people would certainly put that under the stupid dumb question category. But with his mind at play, Einstein felt this unconstrained need to challenge the nature of space and time, and hence were born his theories on general and special relativity. from one dumb, stupid question. Questions are underrated in our conformist society. We are reluctant to raise our hand because we fear acknowledging our own ignorance. We maintain a carefully curated image, pretending to know it all by smiling, nodding, and faking ourselves along the way. But when we don't ask dumb questions, we are sort of confined into our comfort zone that puts us within the realms of the status quo. Actor and one of the finest comedians India has produced has an interesting take on this. Here's what he has to say.
The dictionary defines stupidity as a person or situation that showcases a lack of common sense. I submit to you that common sense is overrated. And much worse than that, it's common.
The third principle comes from an article I stumbled upon from a writer called Derek Sivers. The article speaks to how we, as people, are extremely bad judges of our own creation, no matter how good the product is. Now, this is something that every creative can possibly relate to on multiple layers, especially because the internet is so heavily populated with so many opinions on topics that we're interested in discussing. There have been thousands of times where I've shrugged ideas under the carpet because I put them under the people already know this category. As storytellers, we often tell ourselves that the world does not need an article or a piece of content about this topic because it's already been spoken about. And most of the times, we agree and we convince ourselves and rob an awaiting viewer or reader of the amazing experience of seeing an old discussion in a new light. It took me time to realize this, but I've understood that your voice is as important as the message that you're trying to put across. No two writers or speakers or storytellers can have the exact same voice, experience, or perspective. And therein lies the uniqueness of your offering. But the bottom line is, even though the message isn't unique, your voice that carries it can be. And what a difference that can make. And so this video is simply an unoriginal reminder that being the fool, asking dumb questions, and iterating obvious ideas are counterintuitive in our conformist society. But at the end of the day, they're all traits of overcoming the fear of judgments. I'll see you guys in the next one. Cheers.